Today, we're taking these old Macs and giving them a brand new lease on life, thanks to Linux. So first of all, we have a 2012 MacBook Pro we're gonna bring into 2025. We got ourselves a Mac Pro we're turning into a server, and this iMac is about to be a gaming PC, thanks to the Steam Deck. For $75, this Retina MacBook Pro is a really nice piece of hardware that unfortunately hasn't seen a macOS update since 2022. But with a brand new battery, a little bit of TLC, and a copy of Linux, I actually think this could be totally usable today. I will need a substantial amount of Goo Gone. So this is a 2012 MacBook Pro, and these things were really dope when they first came out. Now, there were some problems. It has unupgradable RAM, a proprietary SSD, but if you ignore those admittedly kind of big issues, this thing has a beautiful Retina display. This particular model has seen some wear and tear over the years. The battery also definitely needs to be replaced. So this battery has 1,600 cycles, which is, I probably don't need to tell you, a lot. Oh, dude, that's gross. Oh my. Straight up, this laptop, once we're done with it, should be 100% usable in 2025. And for $75, plus a few bucks more for the battery, after a little bit of cleanup, this MacBook is a lot better than I thought. It's clear that the person who had this before left it in a case because it's super clean. There's just like a couple of minor scuffs. I have, however, picked up a brand new battery for this MacBook. I've never put a battery in one of these. Is this one glued in? Or am I, what?
I don't think so.
Okay. There are no such thing as first party batteries for these. You gotta go and just buy some random sort of battery on Amazon or eBay. It comes with gloves?
Hey.
For what? Oh, right. Right, it's one of these batteries. Oh my gosh, holy. Wow, this'll be easy to install, right? This video was sponsored by Hollyland and their new Lark A1. Over 20 million professionals trust Hollyland, us included, which is why I'm excited to tell you about the Lark A1, which is a great wireless microphone at a truly incredible price. We've all been there. You're recording an amazing moment for your new video, but the audio is crunchy, terrible, and cuts out. With the Lark A1, you can easily attach the receiver to your phone and magnetically attach the mic anywhere. With three levels of noise canceling, 24-bit 48 kHz Pro audio, and several EQ options, you can say goodbye to garbage audio. Don't believe me? Well, I'm wearing the Lark A1 right now. Just listen to that audio bliss, baby. The best part? The Lark A1 Mini Duo, which is the mic and USB receiver, is just $29. Yeah. If you want the full combo with the charging case, it's still only $59, which is a fraction the price of our old pro gear. So if you want to up your audio game with an easy to use, great sounding, and affordable solution, definitely check out this Lark A1 using the link in the description. And thanks again to Hollyland for making us all sound a little bit better. I've had decent luck with these, so it should be okay. It'll certainly be an upgrade as long as it doesn't catch on fire. I'll say though, this MacBook is probably about the oldest computer in general that I would actually want to use on a regular basis. Honestly, the biggest problem with these guys is the fact that you have to use old school chargers. I have to put so much pressure to get it in. Inside we have, okay, so original battery and very dirty on the inside. This one, I don't think someone's actually opened because it is absolutely caked up. I'm gonna take this outside and go blow it out real quick. There's like an ecosystem in here. All right, so we have cleaned out the inside of this MacBook where there was a lot of dust. We've also removed the original battery, which was not fun to remove. So let's put in our new battery. I actually say it should drop in, but it's so many like individual cells. I almost have to kind of like line it up. I'll see you on the other side once I've got this thing glued, taped, screwed, and reassembled. So about that new battery, it kind of doesn't work. So yesterday when I got the battery installed, it didn't initially want to hold a charge. So I'm like, whatever, I'm just gonna let it charge overnight and figure it out. But the problem is that the battery still holds no charge after being plugged in for like 15 hours. So with the laptop plugged in, it does work. So you can see here, it shows the battery is installed, so it's detecting it. It does, however, say service recommended. If I unplug it, laptop immediately dies. I've seen this before with third-party batteries. That's the problem because you can't get a first-party battery. Like, Apple does not sell it anymore. And honestly, the quality control on these are just not good. Time to put the original battery back in. So with the original battery reinstalled for the time being, why don't we do something that we can actually make progress on today, which is to install Linux. More specifically, we're actually gonna try two different things here. So I'm gonna start out by installing ChromeOS. Now that might sound like a massive downgrade, however, there actually are some good reasons. First of all, ChromeOS Flex is easily available and super easy to install. And ChromeOS, while you might think about those nasty plastic Chromebooks you had to use in school or whatever, it's actually pretty decent. So with our USB installer created, which is super simple to do, we're going to hit restart. And as soon as it turns off, I'm gonna tap and hold the Alt/Option key. Now we have a number of options. Why is there a drive in here that says Windows? Oh, it's booting into ChromeOS. Okay, that's super weird. The good thing about ChromeOS Flex is it is dead simple. As you can see here, that took 20 seconds and we are already ready to go. But I wanna do something a little bit more ambitious, which is to install Linux Mint. So while ChromeOS is nice, you can do a lot of stuff with it, it's still a glorified version of Google Chrome. This, you can install anything you want. There's no restrictions. I have actually not used Mint or really any normal flavor of Linux in a minute. Immediately before we get started, this is a little bit of a different setup. So you'll see when I plugged in ChromeOS, that was super dead simple. Like I literally just, it was a Chromebook immediately. This is not quite so simple. So there are still the two main modes. I just wanna start it and see, because again, I wanna make sure this is fully functional before I commit to it. So it booted into non-retina mode, which means that everything is the world's tiniest interface. So our touchpad is working. We've got ourselves a keyboard that works. I was like, check the brightness. Yep, brightness is working. But here's my problem. Yes, so there's no Wi-Fi driver. Normally, especially for older Macs like this, you're gonna need to sideload the network drivers. God, it's so small. I can erase the disk and install Linux Mint. You also could resize and do the partitions yourself. The reason you would do that is if you wanted to dual boot. Goodbye being a MacBook, hello being a big old Linux boy. So we have our MacBook up and running. So I did have to connect it to Ethernet. Once I did that, I was able to download the Wi-Fi drivers. Other than that, a couple tweaks, we're up and running with a fully functional MacBook. So as you see, that's embarrassing. You can see I was on r/Linux for noobs.
Yay.
And there we go, we're watching a video. Well, actually, we're playing back at 1440p. One thing I will say that dates this MacBook is the speakers. If you used a MacBook over the last 10 years, you'll know that MacBook speakers are so good. And these speakers are like tucked in the like corners. Most importantly, this MacBook is up and running now, which means it's time to move on to a slightly more ambitious project. This, my friends, is a Mac Pro that I purchased from Goodwill last year for $40. This is the dual CPU configuration, which means this is an 8-core CPU from the year 2008. I have big plans for this. So if you crack open the Mac Pro, it has 4 individual drive sleds, which means that if we want to turn this into a server, we can load up quite a lot of storage. I know there's a couple of issues. The optical drive doesn't work, which is actually kind of unfortunate because my plan is to install TrueNAS. Now this is software that essentially will turn this into a NAS on our networks. I'm not confident that this will work. This system, may I remind you, is from 2008. We need to clean it up because I'll tell you, it's very dirty. I wanna try to actually install a 10 gig Ethernet card. First of all, let's just make sure that our Mac Pro still actually works.
Ooh. We got lights.
No. The Mac Pro's on. I almost think it's the monitor, if I'm honest with you. After pulling out our Apple Cinema display, the Mac Pro is much happier and it is up and running. We have a quad-core Intel Xeon, but 2 of them, which means we have a total of 8 cores and 6 gigs of RAM. I did preemptively order more RAM because one thing you need for something like a server or NAS or something is plenty of RAM. This all looks like it is exactly what I hoped for. Let's clean it out a little bit because it's very dusty. And let me start by trying to upgrade the RAM, which actually should be kind of fun. So after dusting it out a little bit, let me show you something truly revolutionary. So there was one little latch to open up the side. Then all you gotta do is pull off this little panel here. Now we can see our dual CPU coolers. And then to upgrade the RAM, this is gonna be a really difficult maneuver. So just, you know, pay attention. We're gonna take these 2 tabs and pull, and there you go.
Wait. What are these dinguses on the RAM? Do you see these giant dinguses?
So now let's take a look at the RAM I ordered on eBay and see if this actually works. Now the seller I bought this from said that he had pulled this out of his Mac Pro. Here we have. 32 gigabytes of RAM to absolutely load this up. I think I paid, was it 75 for the RAM?
Correct, yes.
These are each 4 gigabytes of DDR2 ECC RAM. Okay, So we have ourselves both of our little RAM trays. So now I just need to lock these guys in and hope that this actually boots.
It's a lot of dust.
So with our 32 gigabytes of RAM installed, let's see if the Mac Pro likes it. Okay, that's a good sign. Some signs of life, at least. Ooh! Hey, yo! 32 gigs of RAM, let's go! Next up, let me grab our hard drives. So these are Iron Wolf NAS drives from Seagate. These are 10 terabytes each. I will say that these drives have a lot of hours on them. These were all functioning when they were pulled out of the server. They just got cycled out. My next step is to go ahead and shut this down.
There's a lot of cables here.
I'm gonna.
do you need an extra hand?
Nope, I believe in myself.
Brother.
Oh, that did not sound great.
So this is the original 320 gigabyte hard drive. Let me load up these hard drives, see if I can find that 10 gig card, and we're gonna see if we can get this Mac Pro to become, I'm not gonna say ultimate, but really useful again. And so we have some level of success. So TrueNAS is installed on our Mac Pro. This is almost ready, however, we do need to get it online. So I've got a console here. The main thing is once you get it up and running, it's actually completely remotely controlled via another computer over a web interface. We have installed an Intel 10 gig card, which theoretically give us really high quality speeds. So we see that there are three interfaces. Okay, so it's a local domain. Oh, it grabbed itself an IP address. Excellent. Woo. Ho ho, buddy, we're up and running. This is where you get a ton of information about your system and make sure it actually works. We're gonna erase everything on those four hard drives. Still spinning? Boom, there we go. Theoretically, I can actually just set up a share, put this on the network, and just try to use it. Okay, so I'm downstairs in my office, still on the same network, but importantly, I'm connected to my iMac, which does have a 10 gig Ethernet connection. So first test I can do is let's just try to copy a file over and see what happens. So I'm just gonna drag it in here to my new folder. We're gonna see. Oh, that's fast, dude. That's 4.45 gigabits a second. Wait, what? That's really fast. We just copied a 10 gig file over in what, 20 seconds? So I did confirm, by the way, that TrueNAS does see both of our quad core CPUs. So we do see all 8 CPUs. And theoretically, as I scrub through this, you should see those CPUs lighting up upstairs, I would presume. Let me actually do a speed test here and actually see what kind of speeds we're getting. Dude, that's a consistent just under 500 megabytes per second. How about reads? Dude, 600, let's go. Can I admit something that I'm a little embarrassed to say? We have another TrueNAS server, which Linus helped us build back in like 2017, which we still use on a regular basis. I don't have this fast of speeds on it. This is a great segue into our next item, which I will say I'm a little bit more concerned about. This is where we're getting serious. As we all know, Macs are good at one thing and one thing only, gaming. Only behind Windows and Linux, clear, very strong number 3. I will freely admit that I got this idea from ETA Prime, who did a video where he purchased an iMac and loaded up with SteamOS. So I purchased myself an iMac from eBay. If it is in good condition and we can get this whole thing up and running, you might be surprised at how good this thing actually is. This, I believe, is a 2017 iMac. The main thing is SteamOS, since it's meant to run on a Steam Deck, it only supports AMD GPUs. And it looks actually really good. Wait, hold on a minute. Oh my God, look, the password is ZZZZZ. So we do actually have two Thunderbolt ports on the back, which is actually pretty nice to have, as well as a bunch of USB 3.0 ports, Ethernet, SD card. I also need a mouse and keyboard, because I don't have a magic mouse around, because, you know, this is a gaming PC. You know, game with a magic mouse. Alex, you should probably correct me if I'm wrong. I think this is just a base model?
It does have a couple of upgrades.
I do believe that this is outfitted with a Fusion drive, right?
That is correct. So that is the other kind of prerequisite to doing this.
I will say it has not moved that little progress bar in a couple minutes. Oh my God, it did something. Oh my God, we're in. That looks pretty good. Hold on. And dude, that's not even 100% brightness. That's 100% brightness. So this is an iMac 18.2, which is a quad core i5. That's
7th gen, 8th gen i5, something like that. 16 gigs of RAM, which is actually quite nice. I think that's one of our upgrades, right?
Yes, so the base one is 8 gigs and it's up to 16.
Wait, this shipped with a regular hard drive and you had to pay?
It ships with a regular hard drive.
Oh, they did, you're right. So graphics wise, it is using a Radeon Pro 555 with 2 gigs of VRAM, which is not a lot. And it does have the 4K, so it's a 4096 by 2304 Retina display. So let us begin by installing SteamOS. Now, the way that you install SteamOS, there's sort of two buckets. There's the officially supported bucket, which would be stuff like a Steam Deck or the Legion Go S. There's the unsupported bucket, so stuff like the ROG Ally, the original Legion Go, and most AMD handhelds. And then there's this, which is not technically in any of these buckets. However, SteamOS is just Linux, and as long as it's got an AMD GPU, most of the time it's good. Theoretically, we can just boot off of it and it will work. Hey, whoa, that's it?
No,
it got no, yes, we obviously need to install it.
Yes.
But that was so easy and fast. Gotta turn my brightness down. Bro, look at that. What we're gonna do is it is going to shred the internal hard drive, get rid of all the macOS, and we're going to load up a copy of SteamOS. This Mac is about to boot into. Oh, the screen turned off. Oh my God! Was that a Steam logo on our iMac? Yeah! Okay, so it does think my battery is low. So I'll make sure to charge up my iMac battery. This is so cool! Come on, y'all, this is so cool. What I'm hoping we can do is run any kind of basic simple games directly off of the Fusion drive, get okay speeds, but for anything that expects an SSD, we can just plug in this external drive. This is a Samsung T5. Holy shit. We're just ready to log into Steam. I'm so happy right now. All right, so we are set up and I have almost exclusively good news. We have Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, we have, of course, our graphics drivers. We can even control a screen brightness, which is lovely. So you have to hop into the settings a little bit, but you can see that we've got brightness controls, including adaptive brightness. So if you open up the storage tab, you'll see we actually have 3 different drives. So we have our internal drive, which shows up as a 15 gigabyte SSD. And then we also have the 1 terabyte hard drive. In macOS, the problem with the Fusion drive is that it was a super slow hard drive paired with a very small SSD cache. But because SteamOS requires an SSD, it sort of broke those two apart. But because I'm impatient and I like quick load times, we have plugged in a Samsung T5 SSD over USB-A. And that is where we have installed Hades. Wait, did I double check the audio works? Hang on, that's the only thing I haven't checked yet. Oh yeah, no, we don't have audio working. Dang it! Also, I don't like the fact that it's just pinwheeling and not loading the game. Yeah, you know, it's like, I should have celebrated when I was in the game, it was working great. Not when I saw an operating system pop up for a second. All right, we'll go ahead and just cancel that real quick. All right, let's try again. Up. Okay. We have some level of progress. Yeah, buddy!
Woo! Okay,
Why did that take so long? That was, okay, it was the first boot though. Now, to be clear, I'm 100% sure that I can figure out a way to get these speakers to work. But in the meantime, let me just plug in a USB speaker just to make sure that this actually works. There we go, I fixed my audio by using a $5 speaker I got on Temu. Is it set to 4K already? Oh, it's already set to 4K. We're playing it full 4K right now. Now, obviously Hades is not exactly the world's most demanding game. Dude, this screen looks phenomenally good. How much do we pay for this iMac again?
We paid $219.
Dude, this screen alone is absolutely worth what we paid. Yes! This, my friends, is exactly what you should do with your old Macs. Now, there's absolutely an argument that a Mac could be updated with something like OpenCore Patcher, but I would argue, especially for older systems, that's not as usable. The fact that you can use Linux to breathe new life into a perfectly functional piece of hardware, you could take something like the Mac Pro, which is 17 years old, and turn it into a bad server. Or you could take this cheap iMac, which is no longer supported, and turn it into a legitimate SteamOS gaming PC. Are you kidding me? Thank you very much for watching. If you enjoyed this, definitely be sure to subscribe to the channel and ring-a-ling that ding-a-ling button. If you've got an old Mac, dust it off, pull it out of your closet, load Linux on it, man. It's fun. Oh, and of course, huge thank you to Hollyland for sponsoring this video. If you like the audio you've heard from this video and you'd like to save a few bucks like you like to save a few bucks with your Macs, definitely be sure to go check them out at the link in the description. So stoked right now, dude.